see if coming through to everybody. Good afternoon and a very late Sunday afternoon, almost, well, Sunday evening. Sunset and the post-sunset glow reflecting on clouds. I have to apologize if we're only coming through now. We have had some
Hello, everyone.
Rather serious
being out in the
issues.
Bush and being out there live has its technical challenges. We're experiencing some of that now and are working
and
on it.
And wouldn't you know that, of course, on a day when we're having some sort of issue is a day when we had some amazing elephant. I think Scott had some ellies. He had a family of ellies on Central Road. Liam and myself, my name is Mark, by the way. This is Wild Earth. This is our Sunday afternoon drive. And I was at Biffles at Dam with a bunch of buffalo, and then an elephant arrived, and then another one. And then in a short space of time, there were 22 elephants around the dam. Some started moving off. Before we knew it, there were more and more, and it was like somebody opened the elephant valve, and they flowed into the dam. But I'll tell you all about that at Fireside Chat a little bit later. Welcome to our drive. I hope we are live. The good news was that Karula was seen around the lodge this afternoon, and Scott actually got to see her. I'll find out from him around Fireside Chat this evening. He can fill us in on that. But they lost her in a very deep drainage zone where we have had leopards disappearing before. They just dropped down into a very deep drainage line that has sides that are maybe 15 feet high. No way of getting in there other than on foot. And, well, maybe she'll come out here somewhere. Maybe she's gone up to quarantine. Sky cleared a little bit. We did have a little bit of rain this morning after drive. Came down in a drizzle that was almost like melted snow. It was a sleet. I don't know what to call it. It wasn't even a drizzle. It was such fine rain that it fell in slow motion. Did you see this?
That rain that fell in slow motion.
Yeah, it was almost like snow.
Well, yeah, snow that wasn't. Things damp, and it was pleasant because it kept the morning cool, but then afternoon came around and the sky started opening. In fact, there is even a moon, or wait, half turn behind us. When I get the opportunity to, in a little while, we'll be able to turn and see the moon. But waxing gibbous, we're about, I'd say maybe 2 days after. About 2 days after first quarter, so we're probably only about five or six days from full moon. And bright moon it'll be tonight. There's a vulture. That's interesting. A vulture. Could be there's been something in here. This is more or less where Karula was heading, and I wonder if she hasn't maybe had something here, and then she went to the dam to have a drink and to somehow come back here. getting a bit late, getting a bit dark to walk around in here. Very dense.
Is it also when we lost the skunk on?
Really?
Yeah, it's sort of misdirection.
The thing with a vulture sitting in a tree is it's not necessarily right on top of the kill as one might find in a cartoon. Vultures can sit even 500 yards away and keep an eye on things until they get a chance to get in there when the predator is not looking or when the predator leaves it. Vulture won't go onto the ground. Because they do go onto the ground, they keep their distance. Depending on what predator it is, of course. Interesting. Thanks. So are we still going live or we are? Okay, well that's good to know. And between Alex, who's I think Alex and Nikki in final control and Scott at the mast and the radio network that we have switching things on and off. And, well, unfortunately it's taken a while, but fortunately we're back. Everything's up and running, which is great. And I think what we are going to do soon is maybe see what Scott is going to be up to, and I'll head back to get a fire going and get set up for fireside chat. We want to have fireside chat at 7 o'clock this evening. We would like to switch over from the vehicle. Are you going to head back to where that last lock was? Found out that Scott, because he might be wanting to go. I think he knows where Karula was. We were up on Biffleswick Dam time, and I know she was somewhere near the front of Fuyatela. But it'll be time now during this evening dusk period, this is what we call animals that are out now known as crepuscular animals. Certain birds and bats and things. Oops. Very strong smell of potato bush. Flowers of a bush called potato bush. Smells like freshly peeled potatoes or frying chips or the like. me, Drongo. See if there's any luck at Gary Dam. I was waiting to hear from Scott about what his plans were and maybe going back to look for Karula. Okay, copy. I'm just waiting for word to give a link, but I'll just see what's at the dam quickly in case he came back this way. Diane, hello Diane, Michigan. Diane missed the name of the Vulture. I don't even think I said the name of the Vulture, Diane. I'm sorry, my apologies. It was a white-backed Vulture. And I'm pretty sure there might be something in there where he is, where it is. Might be worth looking at. Scott, come in. I came back from Buffleshook Dam on Gallagher Shortcut, and just a little bit further north of that shortcut that goes up to Buffleshook, there was Gorty in a tree, a whiteback. That's something that Fiam said that's more or less where you lost the Skankanum Konzo this morning. Well, with Impala coming down to the dam to drink very late in the afternoon for them to drink, I'm not too sure whether that has any that is a result of just weather, or it is pretty late. They're all in front of the light right now, in front of where the camera would have been. Sorry, repeat that please. Scott, come in, didn't copy. No, I didn't take the shortcut, I came Gallagher Shortcut. Now hopefully we're going to get the camera back up in the next day or two, and we'll be able to see, because where those Impala are would be directly in front of where the camera ordinarily is. But I think, since I'm not seeing much, if there are Impala here, if Karula shows her face, I'm sure there's going to be the likes of alarming. She might even go into sort of a stalking mode or something. So I'm going to head back to camp, I'm going to get fire going, and we're going to set up for fireside chat, BM and I, and I'm going to hand you over to Scott for the rest of it, for another few minutes before we get to fireside chat. And I guess the next time I'll see you, I'll be in the glow of a fire. Somebody remind Scott to look at the moon and Venus, because I've still got my back to them, for some reason.
Good evening and welcome on board. big apology about the lack of broadcast this evening, as I'm sure Mark has also said. But nobody knows what caused the problem, so at least our genius Alex managed to fix the problem all the way from Moscow in Russia. So that's pretty hard to believe, but with his guidance and him tweaking a few things from all the way over there, he's managed to get the broadcast back, which is quite incredible, I find. Myself and Romeo are now searching for Karula. She was last seen heading towards where we are now, but the guys couldn't follow her. It was very thick.
Hey, stop. Straight ahead. Oh, here she comes.
Well done, Romeo. So, we've just hit the jackpot once again, and she is going to come into the lights. Oh, she's going to keep coming straight towards us. I'm just going to keep reversing and get out of her way, and that way we're going to get a great shot of her as she comes around the corner. Hello, gorgeous lady. So, we got a lot luckier than I anticipated.
Reversing.
Actually, we're not. We'll let her go past because it's a tricky place to reverse. Pass and then reposition. Well, we couldn't have got luckier than that. As you heard me saying, she was last seen heading in this direction. That was probably an hour ago. And what a luck. It's going to be tricky following her here, so let's hope we can manage to. Big open clearing she's just about to get to, which will be great, but thereafter it becomes very thick, so let's just see what happens. I'm just going to position myself on the other side of a waterhole in the hope that she may come and drink from it. Lights off temporarily just to make sure there's no prey in the area. I would hate to illuminate her if there are any prey opportunities around, but it appears that there are none. How beautiful is this? She is heading straight towards this waterhole. And I think we are going to get absolutely spoiled rotten with an incredible visual in the next few moments. I'm sure you can even hear her lapping up the water. She's so close to us, and isn't this magical? station's located Karula. She's drinking out of the small water hole in front of the Galago camp. Affirmative, you're more than welcome to join. Just got a question through from Christy on Twitter, and she's interested to know whether I think Karula's pregnant or not. Now, simply judging from the way she looks, I wouldn't be able to say so. But what I do know is that I'm sure she has mated since she lost her cubs, and they can mate very shortly after they do lose cubs. Within a week or two, they can come into season again. And then it's only a 3-month period, so she lost her cubs at the end of December. Therefore, if she mated in the first few weeks of January, that would take you to middle of February, middle of March, middle of April. Hopefully there will be some cubs. Hard to say, and only time will tell. Now I fear that where she's heading is going to mean we cannot follow her. It's extremely thick. Sean, confirm that's it's you interested in Karula? Copy, I wouldn't rush. She's just heading down into some incredibly thick vegetation along the fence that runs in front of Gallagher Camp. Negative, kind of more back down towards the dam. On the kind of northern side of the lodge. Copy, I'll try my best to... there's no way I'm going to be able to stay with her here. She's just dropped into the drainage line.
Fishes?
What?
Still got visual.
Where? Is it straight ahead of us?
Yeah. Keep your lights on. You see the slight little bit of spot.
Okay. Well spotted right there.
Thank you.
Yeah, affirmative. Like I say, it's extremely thick. There's no way you'll be able to get a vehicle in here.
Okay.
Copy, good idea. I'm also going to stay in the area in the hope that she ends up following the fence around to that drainage line that runs in front of the Riatella rooms. A negative, the no guess that I'm aware of. Okay, folks, apologies for that, but I just needed to keep Sean updated on her movements. We are not giving up on her just yet. It's just incredibly thick there, and there's no ways we'd be able to follow her. What we're going to do is we're going to loop ahead and try and see if we can't find her. My guess is that from where she is now, she's going to follow the perimeter electric fence that surrounds Gallagher and Vuyatela camp, the two camps here at Djuma, and that would lead her to the Vuyatela Dam. So, that is the plan. Who knows what we'll bump into along the way. There we go again. what to do. It's incredible how comfortable and relaxed she is when she does move around the periphery of the camp. So, the fence that surrounds the perimeter of the camp, which is kind of semi-leopard-proof, I guess, is just in front of us. Negative just standing by her in the hope that she pops out. Sounds good. I'm hoping she's going to follow this fence around in the direction that she was heading. It was a fair distance off from where we are now, but worth us sticking around for a few moments. And Sean's also in the area, so he's just standing by not too far from us. So we've got as many of our bases covered as possible. And like I said, it'll just be a few minutes here. And we may hear some alarm calls that could help to identify her position. But at the moment, we just have to sit and listen. Romeo, what do you think about trying to see what the moon's up to through the camera while we wait? Is it possible?
Anything's possible.
Well, there we go. Just got a question through from Doug in Connecticut, and I hope you're enjoying the shot of the moon. Well done, Jason, that looks great. And evening, Doug. I was interested to know whether we know of any of the last whereabouts of Quarantine from this morning. And I left him shortly after 9 a.m. this morning, shortly after we finished this morning's broadcast. And another game viewer was in the area. He did just get mobile as I left, and within a minute or so, the other vehicle sadly lost visual of him. As you saw, it was very thick in the riverbed, and I did go back and search in that area this afternoon, driving around, exploring on foot, and didn't come up with even a track or any sign of him. So, not sure where he ended up, Doug, but we will hopefully track him down tomorrow morning. So happy to have got a brief glimpse of Karula this evening. She is seldom seen out here, and not as much nearly as she used to be, at least. And we very seldom see female leopards, so wonderful to get a brief glimpse of her, and the timing couldn't have been better this evening. Now the question we are faced with is, how long do we wait here before heading off? Like I say, we did cover a fair amount of distance, while we looped ahead. Copy. Sorry about that.
You asked that question?
I didn't hear the question. I was listening to the Game Drive channel. Go again with the question, please. I was just busy on the Game Drive channel.
Someone asked if we can see Venus. But personally, I don't know what Venus looks like. There is a very red star.
That there is not Venus. Venus will be on the western horizon.
Well, then unfortunately, I can't see Venus. I can't see the western horizon.
Yeah.
Can I?
No.
No. And then also the sound that you're hearing is a cricket. I mean, what's it called?
It could be a cicada, potentially, I'm not too sure, or a cricket, but it really is calling loudly. Maybe it knows something we don't know, maybe Karula's on the way. And phenomenal that sound is, oh yeah, here she is. She went into the camp. She snuck under the fence and went into the camp. And sadly, we missed her. Completely. But that's where she went. Sean, you wouldn't believe it, but she just popped up right in front of me and went straight under the fence into the camp. Copy. Well, who knows? Maybe we will be able to get a visual of her lying on the deck of one of these rooms. Interesting. So, what we can do now, the only thing we can do now is loop around and presume she's going to pop out somewhere else, but wasn't that incredible to watch? Well, sorry, for me.
Sorry.
And the cricket was right. The cricket knew that she was coming. Okay, now I need to get out of here. If you can look for a place where I can try and turn around. That'll work. At least we're keeping track of her movements, and I think she's just taken a shortcut through the camp, which we can't blame her for. And just to let you know, that at a lot of the camps, I'd say probably most in the Sabi Sands, there's not even any fences around the camps, other than that of a very high electric fence, two strands elevated about 1.5 to 2 meters off the ground to prevent elephants coming into the camp surroundings. And that's because the gardens of camps are often manicured, and therefore in winter when it becomes dry, the elephants will come in and cause chaos and rip everything out. So it's not really a major concern. You do need to be careful though when you're walking around at night, but it's not uncommon, especially with leopard, for them to be comfortable within the camp environs, and they know that they're approaching an area where they can expect to bump into humans, so they do it willingly, and as long as you act accordingly, it usually doesn't end in any problems. You will often also be escorted to your rooms from dinners by night porters who are trained and know what to do if they do bump into a leopard or any other dangerous animal that you may encounter. Question from Nicole in Cape Town. Good evening, Nicole, and welcome along. Nicole is interested to know whether it's normal for leopards to be active this early. And it certainly is, and it's not really early, to be honest. I guess early is a word that depends on the individual's own opinions as to what early may be. But it's not uncommon for lion and or leopard to become active in the later hours of the evening when it's a bit cooler, as well as the early hours of the morning when the sun is up. And even in the middle of the day, on the hottest days of summer, leopards can move, so even more prone to moving than lion during the day. So they certainly will move at all hours of the day. That's not to say that they don't spend the majority of their time moving at night. I think that would be a fair assumption in general. But a lot does depend on the individual leopard and also the area in which they live and the time of year. So there's a lot of variables which contribute to leopards' movements, but it's certainly not early for her to be moving. Now, where could she be going? And where does she want to pop out? She's taken that shortcut. Who knows, maybe she's surveying the camp for some potential den sites. Again, something that's not uncommon in the Sabi Sands for leopards to give birth to their cubs within the camp environs, because there's often great infrastructure there, hiding them under eaves of roofs or under decks, as well as the fact that, especially in this case around Galago camp, there's a fence around it that not many predators would be able to get into. So it's a safe haven, you could say, and I've seen that before with other female leopards, and I'm almost certain Karula would have done the same. Maybe not give birth there, but stash her cubs there when she goes off hunting. Now, for those of you who have just tuned in, welcome. And just to let you know, a friendly reminder that it is our fireside chat this evening. So at 7 o'clock, which is in about 20 minutes, we'll be cutting over to Mark, who's currently setting up the fireside chats. And then for 1 hour, we will answer any questions you may be interested in and chat about the highlights of the last week. Everyone know Karula headed into the camp. I'm not sure which room number it is, but she is inside the camp fence. Sorry, go again, please. landscape. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to skirt around the periphery of the camp and see if she doesn't pop out. I'm guessing she will, and she would have just been wanting to take a shortcut that possibly would lead her towards quarantine clearings, would be my guess. I think she might cut through the camp. So let's see what happens if we sneak through this little area. So we've just got a message through from Ellen Fowler. Good evening, Ellen, and welcome back on what is, who knows how many drives you've watched, that would be interesting, but Ellen is one of our long-time viewers. And Ellen has just given us some great information saying that she can confirm Karula has indeed brought cubs from various litters back to the camp over the years. So, as I presumed, she would have. And a lot of female leopards use the camps as safe havens, and who would have thought that would be the case? It really is incredible. Okay, well, no luck. What we'll do is we'll continue driving around and see what else we can find, but we will indefinitely be having to come back to this area for the fireside chats, and who knows, maybe we'll bump into her there. We're very close to our camp where we stay as well here, just a few hundred yards to my right.
Oh, what's that?
Oh, white-tailed mongoose, look at that. Mm-hmm. That's going to be a first for a lot of you. Well spotted, Romeo. Isn't that an interesting creature? One of the largest mongoose we get in this area. And what has it found to eat there? Just try and keep our distance. And enjoy watching this nocturnal mongoose forage around for some snacks. It'll be, like most predators, very flexible in terms of what they feed on. And an assortment of reptiles and rodents will all be on the menu. Base of the Marula tree. Oh. Oh. and for obvious reasons it's been named a white-tailed mongoose. It's got a massive white tail. So this is one of the many small nocturnal inhabitants of Djuma that we so seldom get to see, but now that we are spending longer out at night, our chances will increase greatly of seeing these interesting creatures. I'm going to try and creep forward a little bit closer. We'll just wait for it to move out of shot. Then we will reposition accordingly. Wait for it to hopefully emerge from the other side of these small bushes at the base of the marula tree. It may well be walking directly away from us, out of our sight, but I'm willing to take that risk because we are nice and close now, and if it does pop out, oh, there it does go. We'll also be looking for invertebrates and insects to feed on. What is it doing here? May it be scent marking? It could be scent marking or having a little toilet break, hard to say. We see these animals so seldomly that I certainly don't know a huge amount about their habits. Certainly would be wonderful to see it eat something. Nikki, you probably won't be able to if the vehicle's on the other side of that fence. Time for some grooming, it appears. I certainly wouldn't have expected it to be relaxed enough with us to start grooming itself. And that's wonderful that it is. This mongoose to do its business. I don't want to interfere too much with its evening. Even though it appeared we're having very little impact, I would like to leave it now and head off in search of something else of interest. Such a wonderful evening, not a cloud in the sky, and there was a lot of cloud cover today, and there was even a little bit of rain and drizzle at around lunchtime. So wonderful that it did clear up to be a beautiful afternoon and evening. And thankfully, because of the cloud cover during the day, it's kept things nice and cool. Question through from Jeffrey in Texas. Good evening, Jeffrey, and welcome. Jeffrey is interested to know whether that mongoose will prey on any other mongoose species, and I think it would, provided it had the chance, but the banded mongoose and dwarf mongoose, which are the other two kinds of mongoose that we get here fairly commonly, are diurnal and will be bunkered away in their den sites at night time, which would make it a difficult prey species for the white-tailed mongoose, who's strictly nocturnal. So for that reason, I'd say not likely. You do get some water mongooses that are nocturnal that you'd get in this area, but they're quite large and possibly a bit large for that white-tailed mongoose to feed on, as big as it is. So I think it would focus on smaller prey. Some impala up ahead, that's why I've just dimmed the main lights. And we're gonna have one last loop around to see if we can't have any further luck with Karula. And by then, it will be time for the fireside chat, which Mark is all set up and ready for. And look forward to having another fireside chat this evening. I missed the last one as I was on leave, so certainly looking forward to it this evening. And it's a great opportunity for us to answer some questions that may not necessarily be relevant to what we may be seeing, like when we're on drive, those questions that come through tend to be the relevant ones that we try and answer, whereas now it's more of an open brackets in terms of what can be asked and what will be answered. Come on, Karula. Where are you hiding? He's probably lying on a deck chair on at one of the rooms, really comfortable with a cushion, thinking about which room would be the best to raise her cubs in. Through from Diane in Michigan wanting to know if mongoose do in fact eat snakes, and they certainly will. I personally have never seen it, but I am confident that it does happen, and I've seen footage and photographs of mongoose attacking snakes and even some highly venomous snakes, so they certainly do. Whether the white-tailed mongoose is prone to catching snakes, I'm not entirely sure, but I'm guessing it will definitely have them on its menu. It's often though that I've seen the mongoose that live in clans and are not solitary like the white-tailed mongoose, or the ones that are more prone to attacking snakes. From myself and Romeo, thanks so much for joining us on Drive, and in the next few seconds you'll be cutting across to Mark, who's already at the fireside chat, and it'll just take me a couple of minutes to get them and I will be joining him. So from myself and Jason, we'll see you at the fireside chat in a few minutes.